Now, before we start this video, I have some things I need to admit. Number one, because I know there are going to be a lot of people who hate click this video just to yell at me, let me say, I like Stranger Things. I didn't want to make a video complaining about Stranger Things because I like the show. However, I've always said you could like something and still point out its flaws. I'm worried people will watch this and compare me to the knuckleheads who hate the show just because it's popular, and I don't like those people. I'm not like them. It's okay to like popular, easy-to-swallow media. There's no shame in enjoying something that's made for everyone to enjoy. The point is, I like this show, and it's taking a lot out of me to criticize it, okay? But these are thoughts that I've had for years, and I'm sorry, I just can't keep it inside me any longer. And number two, I originally wrote this script thinking season 3 was the last season. And this was a much different video back then. It was more of a positive look back on the series. I didn't actually check to see if it was the last season, I just assumed it was because I'm dumb. And originally, I was pretty happy because I thought it was cool to end at 3 seasons. But that also stemmed from me believing for many years now that this show should have ended after season 1, and I still firmly believe this. I remember thinking that the show could honestly not top that first season. Almost every element that was great about season 1 was exclusive to season 1. But before we get into that, I'm gonna cover the things that the show does well, because like I said, I like the show, and I think it does a lot of good stuff. Now, if you ask me, this show is a wonderful anomaly. It's a show that shouldn't work the way it does. I remember when season 1 dropped and everybody immediately fell in love with it. This show gets into some pretty wild shit, like eldritch Lovecraftian monsters, parallel shadow dimensions, and Dungeons & Dragons. All elements that are usually pretty tough pills to swallow for the average viewer, especially D&D. And if you ask me, season 1 of Stranger Things is perfect. I honestly can't think of anything wrong with it. It has great pacing, the plot keeps you hooked in all the best ways, the characters are all lovable, and the acting is great, which is even more impressive because most of the characters are little kids. Stranger Things Halloween costumes have been a staple since season 1 came out. Yes, you too can dress up as a normal child for Halloween. The way people latched onto the iconography of the series so quickly is kind of beautiful. The trailer for season 2 started with an Eggo commercial, and everybody immediately knew what it was for. The show is just infectious. The show is also very good at balancing its tone. It's the perfect blend of cute teen dramedy with super dark, violent Stephen King horror. I've talked about tonal consistency before, and Stranger Things is a good example of how to do it right. Darker elements never really feel like they come out of nowhere, and while the lighthearted stuff is oftentimes cutesy and feel good, it's also very genuine and realistic. And like I said before, the characters are the best thing about the show. Many of them seem like they might be stereotypical 80s movie staples at first, but then they develop into way more as the series progresses. In season 1, you think Hopper's just gonna brush off these strange occurrences because in so many stories, when the tough guy cop hears about weird monsters, they would just ignore it. But instead, he kinda believes it, and he goes in and becomes one of the main heroes of the series. Initially, Steve appears to be the cool guy bully who makes fun of our relatable loser main character. But eventually we find out he's actually a pretty chill guy. In season 3, his arc consists of him struggling with how to still be the cool guy after high school is over. He hangs out with the kids because they're the only ones who still think he's cool. He still very much has a high school mentality, so he starts the season by trying to win a new girlfriend. And even though we know that's kinda dumb, the show still subtly convinces us that he'll be rewarded with the right girl for him, because that's what we expect in a story like this. And more importantly, it's what he thinks he needs to solve his problems. But that isn't the case, and instead of the story playing out the way we expect, it shows us something new that's actually better for his character. This is how you subvert expectations, not to try and outsmart the audience. More writers should take note of this because this is a great way to write a simple twist that changes the story for the better. And on top of all this, the show has pretty good music, genuinely sad moments, and a balance of well-written, sharp humor.
Step back.
No.
Seriously.
No! If you die, I die.
Okay.
So you may ask me, but Marcus, if you like all this stuff, why do you think the show needed to end in season 1? Well, that's because while I enjoy watching the show, I think I'm just doing it out of habit now. Because everything that made me fall in love with the show was in season 1, and all that stuff is completely gone now. Now, I think everybody can agree that Stephen King's stories have the biggest impact on this show. I mean, look at the font. The episodes are called chapters. The whole framing of the show is that of a Stephen King novel. Even though he has nothing to do with the production of the show, his style permeates throughout it. The whole tone of this show is that of a story like It or Stand By Me, with young relatable kids dealing with something beyond their understanding. But one key component of a story like this is that there needs to be a sense of mystery. And that is totally gone after the first season of Stranger Things. And if you ask me, that's probably the biggest problem with later seasons. Season 1 ends with a little teaser, and a lot of people have already said to me, "Marcus, you're wrong, because I needed to know what happens to Will Byers after season 1. Because he was sick and he threw up a little demon baby." No, you didn't need to know what happens to him. Lots of great stories end with a loose thread or a shocking cliffhanger to keep you thinking. Do you need a sequel to Inception? No, you don't. Ending on a little taste of mystery is perfect because it's a fucking mystery show. In season 1, you have no idea what's going on for a good while, and then when you start to figure it out, our characters still have to grasp the concepts themselves. In between that, we have genuinely scary horror scenes as well. Remember when Stranger Things was actually scary? Getting chased by CGI meat spiders and monster dogs is not scary. Mainly because once the monsters show up in season 2 and 3, we've already seen them and we understand them too well. Stories like this thrive off of the fear of the unknown, a concept popularized by the Lovecraft stories that this show is inspired by. Season 1 is scarier because we don't know what's happening yet. The show is keeping us in the dark most of the time, and this in turn gets us more excited to binge the show and uncover the mystery for ourselves. In season 2, we've already seen Demogorgons, so seeing a bunch of them is not really that interesting. In season 3, they try to do something different by attempting to do a Body Snatchers storyline, but the show doesn't really use this concept in any interesting ways. I expected all the possessed characters to be tricking our heroes a little more often, but the characters are too smart and they figure it out in like episode 3. In fact, before our characters learn that the townsfolk have been possessed, they don't really interact with them that much. The story also doesn't have much time to do anything with this idea because the show has way too much going on. Season 1 was very tightly focused because all the characters were kind of working towards the same goal, but right now it's kind of all over the place. In season 3, we have 4 or 5 concurrent storylines, and while they do converge into one by the end, it makes the show feel kind of predictable as well. In season 3, I always knew what was going on, and not because I'm saying I'm smarter than everybody, it's because they show you everything that's going on in episode 1. The first episode of season 3 starts by showing us that Russians are trying to open a portal to the Upside Down. Then the episode ends with Billy being possessed by the Mind Flayer. The rest of the season consists of all of our characters trying to learn what we already know. There's nothing new for us as viewers to uncover in this story. In season 1, we're thrown a twist pretty early on when they reveal that Will might be dead. This sends all of our characters into a frenzy, and it throws us for a loop as well, because everything that we're shown has proven otherwise, that he's probably still alive somewhere. This is a great way to shake up the story and make us second guess ourselves, and the later seasons don't have anything like this. Also, I should say it kind of bugs me that our main characters are kind of invincible now. When a few kids can sneak in and out of a top security Russian base multiple times, I start to get a little annoyed. These are just kids after all, and yeah, one of them has superpowers, but other than that, they're normal kids. And if the kids are invincible, it kind of lowers the stakes. Now, I'm not saying any of these characters need to die for there to be stakes. That's not the point. I just think the show needs to come up with new scenarios other than, oh no, a monster's gonna eat the kids. What are they gonna do to get out of this? And that's a problem that comes with dragging a show out longer, because the longer things go on, the more time you have to focus on the negatives. It's the case of this show just being too much of a good thing. You might hear one weak line delivery from a character.
What is wrong with my boy?
And then you start to wonder, is Winona Ryder really a good actress, or is she just good at being an angry mom? You also start to notice little things like the fact that Natalia Dyer has clearly never been drunk before in her whole life, and it is adorable.
It's great. Like, we're in love and we're partying. Yeah, let's party, huh? Party, we're partying. It's bullshit.
The 80s nostalgia masturbation scenes also start to get a little more gratuitous. The whole new coke scene in season 3 stands out as being really misplaced and just weird. Also, as the show goes on, you might notice that we have too many damn characters. I like stuff in these later seasons. I like Bob, I like Alexi, I like Robin, I even like the racist demon man. But as we get more characters, the old characters tend to get pushed to the sidelines. Tell me one thing that Mike does in season 2, because I honestly don't even remember him being there. He's like the main kid in season 1. Hell, he doesn't even really have much to do in season 3 either. He seriously feels like a side character now. Will Byers has the ability to sense demons, but in season 3, he's pretty underused. This is really weird because he's the main focus of season 2, and he's one of the best child actors on the show. Now in season 3, most of the time you just see him in the background looking worried. And this is annoying because I think he had a lot of potential to be the emotional center of this season. The scene of him losing his shit is my favorite thing that I've seen since season 1. But after this incredibly emotional scene, they literally just forget about it and decide to fight demons. The writers seem to have latched onto the characters that the viewers like the most. So, hey, people like Steve and Dustin, right? Okay, so now it's just the Steve and Dustin show. Now don't get me wrong, I love their dynamic, it keeps me watching the show. Steve, Dustin, and Robin are the best thing about season 3. But then, it's soured by them adding another character. Erica just drags scenes down so hard, and I was pretty done with her after her first few lines. And yeah, I could go ahead and climb up on my soapbox and say that I don't really like when one of the only characters that shares the same race as me is delegated to the sassy character. Her existence in this show personally really bothers me, but I'm not really gonna get too far into it right now. I mean, the only saving grace here is that she's supposed to be annoying, but does that actually make it better or worse? I'd also like to mention that I think the actress is doing a great job, I just think the writing on her character needs some work, okay, don't attack me. A lot of people say that even though the show has its problems, the characters are the best thing about it and they drive the show. And honestly, I would be inclined to agree if it weren't for the fact that the characters have actually gotten a little worse. However, there are exceptions, like Steve and maybe Nancy to some extent. I fully believe that Hopper is completely ruined in season 3. He has two modes in season 3. It's either complete jackass or action hero. Now, I'm all for having a character falter and show weakness and maybe be a selfish dick for a little while, if they learn from it. He begs Joyce to go on a date with him, and then eventually she just says, okay, whatever, I'll go on the date with you. Even though he hasn't learned anything and he hasn't changed in any way. He's still the same asshole. He never apologized to anyone. He never showed any remorse for his actions. And then at the end of all that, he gets a fake out death and we don't see him anymore. So he definitely didn't learn anything. And for me, Joyce is kind of just as bad. Joyce is probably the most static character in the whole show. She has just been the distraught, screaming mother for 3 seasons now. It just makes me think the writers need to balance things out a little better. I still would say that the characters are the best thing in the show, and they do drive the show. The best scenes in the season are of the girl shopping, or Will trying to hold on to his friends in any way he can, or the fucking never-ending story scene, which was one of the most genuine laughs I got in season 3. There are still really good moments in the show, but it feels like the writers are leaning really hard on the fact that we love the characters. And as a result, the show has less of a focus on creating an engaging plot. I can honestly say that while I like season 3 way more than season 2, I got really bored of the Russian storyline really fast. Evil Russians are more of a focus here than the fucking mind-controlling demons. While the kids are trying to stop the ghouls from another dimension, we have 2 concurrently running subplots about Russians. I'm sorry, but Russians are way too normal for a show called Stranger Things. But even though this subplot is whack, at least we get to see the characters we love, right? I don't know, man. It just feels like the creative juices are running a little thin. I mean, do you guys remember the X-Men subplot from season 2? That really fucking weird episode where Eleven just goes on a spirit journey? A lot of people would agree that that's probably the worst episode in the entire show. And while things haven't really gotten to be that bad since then, the show still has the problem of introducing subplots that we honestly really don't care that much about. As you watch the show in the moment, you might be enjoying yourself, but the more you sit and think about it, the more it might start to bug you. At least that's what happened with me. adding these really lame subplots just shows me that the show wasn't really meant to go on this long. This is all very hard for me to say because, as I've stated many times before, I think this show is special and it has a lot of potential. I was genuinely enjoying large chunks of this season, but I had that nagging voice in the back of my head that wouldn't stop reminding me of how much I loved season 1. And since then, I haven't felt that same love for the show. For a lot of people, this show is still exactly what they want, and that's fine. I think that's perfectly okay. Like I said, it's okay to enjoy things. The point of this video is not to convince people to stop watching this show. I just wanted to point out stuff that's been bothering me and that's been on my mind for a while. And honestly, it goes beyond just this show. For me personally, I believe there should not be direct sequels to a mystery or horror series like this. If the mystery is solved the first time around, then the story should be over. If our characters understand the monster and overcome it, then that story should be over as well. Unless the characters are going to face an entirely new threat. If you reopen the mystery or face the same monster again, it's not as special anymore. We already experienced that journey. Freddy Krueger and Jason Voorhees aren't scary anymore because we know too much about them and they have like 20 movies each. And if you ask me, the best way to continue a series like Stranger Things is with the anthology format. Taking the tone from the previous seasons and building a new story with new characters and new secrets to uncover. If you can craft a memorable story in like 10 episodes, then that's more impressive to me than dicking around for 7 seasons just to have a shitty ending. Me and a lot of other people had dreamed that Stranger Things would be an anthology show because this story was something special and we knew it couldn't be topped. Exploring a new mystery with new characters would have been so fun. But the problem lies with something that I mentioned before, the iconography. People just latched onto these characters. You can't have all this licensed merchandise and Stranger Things Halloween costumes and Halloween Horror Nights themed haunted houses just to throw all those characters away in later seasons. The show was honestly way too popular for its own good. There was literally no way they could pull off an anthology show after it became such a smash hit. So while I wanted an anthology, I knew I wasn't gonna get it. So now it's hard to enjoy the finale of Stranger Things Season 3 because I know none of the emotional payoff matters. Hopper's letter is sad, yeah, but it's not as sad when you realize he's still alive. The buyer's moving away is also sad, but it's not sad anymore when you realize that Eleven is way too important for the story, so they'll just be inevitably back in season 4. The show is just way too popular to end anytime soon. We're gonna need 1 or 2 or maybe even 3 more seasons. And yeah, I'm gonna watch those seasons like everybody else. After all this bitching and moaning, I will still watch it. Because the show is different from other shows. There are certainly way worse shows to be upset about. But the show being decent is exactly why these things are frustrating, because just think of the impact season 1 would have had if we never saw those characters again and it ended. If it ended there, I think they would have had a much stronger place in our minds instead of overstaying their welcome. I think a lot of people need to realize that sometimes it's okay to let go of things we like. It's okay to just let things end.